This is the CineSnob Podcast.
Hi, and welcome to episode 245 of the CineSnob Podcast. I'm Jerrod Kingery.
I'm Cody Viafania.
Hey, how's it going, Cody?
It's going good. What's that?
Go ahead. Sorry,
Okay, I'm good. I'm coming in off of 3 days at Fantastic Fest, where I watched 14 movies in 3 days. So, my brain is mush.
Yeah, we're off to a good start energy wise here, I think. So I wanted to talk to you about Fantastic Fest. Forgive me, I think we may have mentioned this last week, but is this the first time back in person, or this is the second year back in person?
This is the second year. Last year was like a more of a condensed thing where there was like limited screenings and like there was like buffer seats and stuff like that. This is the first time since, I guess, 2019 that it's been like full gear back.
You're all up in everyone's shit there.
Yes.
And I haven't been to Fantastic Fest in a while. Is it still just at Alamo Drafthouse Lamar, South Lamar?
It is, yeah. And it's you know, as for reasons we'll talk about later, again, I just still love the organization of it because, you know, you and I were talking about, you know, South by Southwest, something that you haven't done in quite some time, I think, at this point.
Since 2019, yeah.
Yeah, and as much fun as South by Southwest is, even if you want to just do films, you have to bounce around everywhere. You have to catch shuttles. You have to, you know, take Ubers if you are running late or walk and it's so nice to have a festival where literally it's all in one place. So you never, you know, right. I was parking at the Lamar garage at, you know, 9 a.m. And then I left it close to 2 a.m. and you don't have to move.
Yeah. I remember getting stuck in that Lamar garage several times, and I have been before, but, it is nice. The redo of that theater area like completely killed the character, but I gotta admit the parking garage is nice.
It's super nice. It's an interesting area too, because it's like, and I'll get into this. I wanted to do just some tips for people if they want to go next year, but it's turned into this kind of high end shopping center where
everything has, man. Everything has.
Everything is super expensive to eat there, and like even the fast food option is Shake Shack, which is expensive. It's a really nice area though. I actually, you know, the character of the theater, yeah, I could see that, but the highball is still there, which is a fun place to go. And
it's not the old highball, but
it's not the old highball, no. Yeah. But
yeah. I mean, I'm talking about stuff that's been gone for like 8 years now.
Yeah.
I don't know why I'm waxing nostalgic about it now, but anyway, so you want to talk a little bit about what you saw?
Yeah, so I just, you know, just kind of highlighting, like I said, I've seen, and I'm still kind of in the middle of it. There's still an at-home portion that we'll cover, but 14 movies in 3 days for me. You know, just some highlights. I saw the new, I believe it's a Searchlight film, The Menu. With Ralph Fiennes and Anya Taylor-Joy and Nicholas Hoult, which is sort of like... you know how Pig like covered foodie culture but didn't do it in like a humorous way, but it was like still there in terms of its sort of like you know, talking about like Portland food scene and stuff. You know, this is a movie that really embraces this sort of like ridiculousness of like chef and foodie culture I don't know if you know this, but it's directed by Mark Mylod, who is best known for, or most recently known for, directing episodes of Succession. And so it's a nice fit for like that kind of like railing on the upper class kind of thing. And I really had fun with it. It kind of goes in directions that, you may not necessarily think. And Ralph Fiennes is like, you know, pun intended, making a meal out of every, you know, line of dialogue he has, playing the chef at this very exclusive like dinner club where like a dark thing is revealed. So
I've seen the trailer like three times, the last three times I've been to the movies. I don't think that's any secret what the secret is.
I think I know where you're going, and I think you're not super right about that.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Interesting.
But but yeah, so I had a lot of fun with the menu. Some other highlights I saw, the Banshees of Inisherin, the new.
I know you were looking forward to that one.
Martin McDonagh movie, yeah. You know, reuniting Colin Firth and Brendan Gleeson. And I enjoyed it. It's very dialogue heavy. I think a lot of people were, you know, he had made two movies in a row starring that were like, American movies, quote unquote. You know, Seven Psychopaths, I believe, took place in the United States. And then you have Three Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri. And I think that this is probably my third favorite. I would go In Bruges, and then Seven Psychopaths, and then Banshees. But, you know, it features great performances. Colin Farrell, I feel like, has morphed into one of the most consistent actors there is. It's another great performance from him. And then him and Gleason work really well together. So I think that, you know, we'll cover these in full, obviously. And then let's see here. There's opportunities to see like smaller movies too, and I think one of my favorites of the smaller movies was I watched this movie called The Antares Paradox. I believe the director is from Spain, it was a movie that was basically about a woman who's trying to prove the existence of extraterrestrials, and she gets a signal inside this like. Basically, she's working like a satellite and monitoring connections, and she gets a signal, and then she finds out that like some family crisis is happening, and she's trying to decide, you know, does she stay there and verify this important piece of, you know, information, or, you know, does she attend to her family? And so it's one of those movies that takes place all in one location, and she's the only actress that's like in the movie. So mm-hmm. basically, every other interaction she has is either on the phone or on a video screen. Like a video chat, and then she's just kind of staying in one place put. So like it's sort of like, you know, they described it in reference to The Guilty, or a movie like Buried or something like that, where it's just like one character in one spot. I think it, you know, it occasionally gets a little bit long. It occasionally gets a little bit saccharine, but I good, you know, debut effort. I saw a Decision to Leave also, which is the new film from Park Chan-wook, and it is the South Korean submission for the Oscars this year coming up, and it's this movie about basically it's like a police movie where you have this detective and he's investigating a murder, but then he starts to like kind of develop feelings for a suspect. Who's basically her husband, and so he watches her and like keeps track of her and investigates her, but then they end up developing a relationship. And for me, the way that I felt about it was that the first 90 minutes of this movie, if it would have like cut off there, it would have been my favorite movie of the year. But it had like another 45 minutes to go, and I think it lost a little bit of steam. And you know, those frustrating experiences where you're like, if it just like there, and there's like a natural conclusion too. And I'm like, if you just stop it right there, you got like a top 10 movie for me. That being said, it's still a really lovely movie, beautifully shot, beautifully executed, you know, really thematically interesting. So yeah, those were some highlights for me. Trying to look at my schedule and see if I'm missing anything that I, that's worth talking about, but
you didn't go to the secret screening, which ended up being the
I did go,
and that was the Marvel, what is it called?
It's called Werewolf by Night,
a Halloween special that's coming to Disney Plus. How was it just in general? Are you allowed to talk about it? I assume so, right?
I think so. So it's I don't know if you know this, but it's directed by Michael Giacchino.
Mm-hmm. I did know that, yes.
So it's sort of like because I think he's made like a Star Trek animated thing. He directed that, and I think he said he directed that some short film with Ben Schwartz and Patton Oswalt he directed. But this is his first feature length-ish thing. It's like, you know, somewhere between 45 minutes and an hour. And it really is like a throwback to like 50s horror. It's all black and white except for the last like 2 minutes of it. So it's like a full-on black and white special. And it's kind of like a throwback again to like a monster movie type thing. I'm not the best person to give the most fair assessment of this because the wind was taken from my sails just a slight bit. I don't want to be too harsh on it, but you know, it's one of those things where, you know, the build up to this thing is crazy, and you know, you're waiting in the lobby for like an hour for everyone to be seated, and there's tension, and it was just one of those
things. You're
thinking
it's going to be Knives Out 2, Glass Onion.
Yeah, I was thinking, my thought in that moment was like, I hope it's Glass Onion because I'd like to see that. In the worst case scenario is it's Halloween Ends. Like, I thought that was worst case scenario. But it ended up being Werewolf by Night. you know, I think it's
it could have been the Munsters.
Oh, that's true. you know what? I thought it was okay for me. It didn't really do anything for me. I wasn't the most happy audience member at that point. Just because it wasn't what I was expecting. I would have preferred something feature length. One thing I wanted to ask you, because there was one more movie I wanted to touch on. Have you ever seen a movie by Quentin Dupuis?
Not that I am aware of.
So he's the guy who made Rubber, if you remember that movie. That was about like a tire that goes on a killing rampage.
Oh, yes, I remember hearing about it. I never saw that.
Yeah. So he's a French director who's known for making like super weird movies, and so I saw his new one called Smoking Causes Coughing, and it's basically like this. It's like a halfway superhero parody about this superhero group called the Tobacco Force, and they basically each have a power of like a characteristic of tobacco, and they use it to beat up these like really fake looking rubber aliens, and it's really stupid. And then it like takes these weird vignettes of like people telling stories, and like it's not necessarily cohesive. It feels like almost like an anthology at times. But man, like some of the funniest shit I've seen all year happens in this movie, and it makes me really interested to take on some of his other movies and see how they are. But I really had fun with it. I'd be curious to see. Maybe we'll talk about it when it comes out eventually. But I found it to be really funny.
Now, has it lost some of its the festival lost some of its like weirdo cred? Because it seems like. Like there's a lot more mainstream stuff playing.
You know, I would say it's become more of a balance, because I think if anything, when it, you know, in previous years, it swung the other way, which was that it was all weirdo stuff.
Right.
And I think they've compensated for it in a really interesting way where you can go and you can watch, you know, mainstream-ish or big distributor or studio sort of genre film. And also mix it in with like really interesting, and I think part of the most interesting thing they've done is like also added this dimension of foreign language films, these international films that can be lots of different genres. You know, Decision to Leave is like a police drama. I've seen like samurai movies there. I've seen The Raid style, you know, Indonesian action movies and stuff like that. So. You know, you know, they're expanding beyond just the weird and bizarre, and they're going into like, you know, really interesting international foreign cinema. Now, the weirdo culture, I think there's less of the like showing porno films in theaters.
I got stung with that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thanks. Thanks, Tim League and Nicholas Wending Refn. You fucks.
Yeah. Yeah, I heard about that. I think there's less of a chance that happens this year. But I mean, you know, it's certainly a, you know, I mean, I also saw, I won't really talk about it, I'll wait for this one later, but like Bones and All as well, you know, the new Luca Guadagnino with Timothy Chalamet movie.
about cannibals.
About cannibals, yeah.
The poor Army Hammer is just sitting there watching behind glass somewhere.
I actually never put that together.
Oh, really? That's been a joke across film Twitter for a little while that he has to watch Timothy Chalamet and Luca Guadagnino, I fucked up his name, but make a cannibal movie while he's a pariah.
that is wow. but yeah, so anyway, to answer your question, I don't think that it's lost a lot of it. I just think it feels a little bit more balanced. And also, you know, the great thing about the way that it's structured is that, you know, every round there's four different movies usually, if not more. And so if you're not into this, you know, mainstream stuff, you can take a stab on a weird movie or you know, a foreign movie or a restoration of some old thing. And so, yeah. One other thing I was going to ask you about too. Did you ever watch anything related to Ultraman?
Oh, I've seen Ultraman stuff. I was never really into the dubbed. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like Power Ranger related. I think that's when I kind of saw it. And I remember, when we were in Japan, I bought an Ultraman figure for a collector friend of mine. Mm-hmm. But that's really the extent of it. I don't know much about it.
Okay, so another movie I saw was Shin Ultraman, which was the same director as the Shin Godzilla. And so
I hated Shin Godzilla.
Well, in that movie gets, and to be fair, Shin Ultraman's a little bit more entertaining because Shin Godzilla gets so wrapped up in Japanese bureaucracy.
It's like satirical, yeah, it's a Japanese bureaucracy satire. And like, fuck, man, I don't get it. Like,
yeah, and there's some of that in Ultraman, but it's a little bit more fun and enjoyable. So that was a fun little treat.
I assume it's still a man in a suit, not
mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah. That's cool. It's one of those things I know about, but I've never really experienced. So
yeah,
interesting.
But yeah, and just you know to wrap up, I Fantastic Fest, it continues to be again such a well organized festival where again having it all in one place. The line management was good. You know, they changed the ticketing system up this year, but you knew exactly what you were getting into. You know, there's not, that mad dash to get to the theater or whatever. You know, if you've got a ticket, right, you're good. I think if anyone, you know, is interested in genre film, if you're into horror, sci-fi, action movies, kung fu, martial arts, and then international foreign films, there's a lot to really enjoy. You know, I think it does run the risk eventually of getting that too mainstream. I mean, I think, you know, having a secret screening be a Marvel TV show that's airing on streaming is not the best indicator of things. But who knows what that second one's going to be. Maybe it's you know, a redeeming thing. But, you know, it's typically well curated. I only had one movie that I saw where I was just, like, super not into it out of 14. You know, the mm-hmm. rest were completely like watchable to pretty good. And so, you know, the curation is strong with it. You know, if you're going to go in future years, I would say, like, you know, one thing I noticed this year more than any others is that people were going to their cars in between movies, in the garage, and they had coolers and they were just kind of hanging out, eating and drinking and stuff like
Damn.
That.
It's a great idea.
Super, super smart idea, because unless you want to eat draft house food, you know,
at 8 a.m.
yeah. You know, it gets costly. And also, you know, if you've had their menu before, you kind of know what you're getting, and it's, you can't change that up too much. And then everything in the area is kind of expensive. So I would definitely go that route if you have the means to, in your parking, to like put some food and drinks in the cooler and hang out there. Kind of had like a tailgating atmosphere to it. And then, like, again, just sort of like being open, like with any festival where, you know, there were, you know, they show stuff twice. And so, you know, the hot tickets are going to be seeing the first round of, you know, Bones and All or whatever. And so, you know, that's a good opportunity to kind of explore elsewhere and then come back to it later. So, you know, I had a great time again. And I'm looking forward to the at home portion, which is coming up here.
You didn't see Satanic Hispanics, did you?
I didn't. No, I I think I had a maybe have a screener. I can't remember, but I did not see it at the festival.
I actually, a friend of mine actually wrote one of the segments. I don't know which one.
Oh, really?
But he messaged me on Instagram about it. So Pete Barnstrom is his name. Anyway, yeah, that's where Jonah Ray was there for.
Okay.
I know you mentioned running across Jonah Ray. He's in one of those.
Yeah,
it's like an anthology of horror movies from Hispanic directors.
That's right. That would have been why he was there. I was trying to think. I was running down, like, there were a lack of famous people this time around. I walked by Jonah Ray, David Ferrier, the guy who he had a movie there, Mr. Organ. That's his.
Did you see?
Tickle.
Did you see Elijah Wood?
Did not see Elijah Wood. I saw Ryan Johnson.
Okay. That's why you thought it was going to be Glass Onion.
Yeah. But he was there for, and this was a good movie too. This will be on Shudder. Maybe we'll cover it in a few weeks or whenever it's out. Blood Relatives, it's the directorial debut from Noah Segan, who is sort of like his J.J. Abrams, Greg Grunberg? What is that? The guy who's in all of his shit, right?
Really?
Yeah.
Interesting. Greg Grunberg, yeah. Back in from the Felicity days and all.
Yeah. He's the J.J. Abrams lucky charm, and so that's kind of like Noah Segan's and all of Ryan Johnson's stuff.
He's not the guy that took the role from Kelly Marie Tran. Who was that? The Hobbit guy. God damn it. I can't remember his name. Who was also in Lost.
Oh, yeah.
Shit. What is his name? Fuck.
I don't remember.
God damn it. Anyway.
But yeah, and so...
It's like half the cast of Lost took her role in that movie. Sorry.
Yeah. The one thing they could improve on the Fantastic Fest side, I think, is like communication with certain things. Like it was showing what was supposed to have a live Q&A, and there was supposed to be one for Bones and All, and it's advertised and all that stuff. And so we get into the theater, and they're like, oh, by the way, you know, Luca Guadagnino is not here. And but he recorded a message, and there's a message of him, and he's like, hey, I'm in Budapest, I wish I could make it. I'm like, you didn't know this, like, at the time, like you couldn't have told people, hey, there's no Q, because people are fighting to get into the screening, or excuse me, the theater that has the Q&A in it, and so people were essentially, like, you know, fighting over tickets for nothing. And I say fighting as in, like, it's a mad dash in the app to get, you know, theaters before they sell out or whatever, so... you know, a little bit of communication, but, you know, all things considered, a fun time at the festival.
Cool. Yeah, one of these days I'll go back. It's just, I can't, I was, like, way too taxed doing it, like, five movies in one day. Like, it's tough. Anyway, anything else to add before we move on?
No, we'll just be covering the second half, which has I think they said, like, 20 features from the festival in person are carrying over to the at home, and then I think 15 original, like, platform exclusive. So if you're interested in seeing, like, what it's all about and getting a sampling, I believe that they still have Fantastic Fest at home badges or passes or whatever available right now.
Yeah, I got an email from Draft House about that yesterday or the day before. It's interesting.
Yeah, and it's let me take a look and see if I can get some info on it. But it starts on Thursday, and it goes until Thursday the 29th through Tuesday, October 4th, is Fantastic Fest at home. So if anyone is interested in it, you can go to the Fantastic Fest website, and it's $175 for that.
Yeah, I did get an email from Draft House about it, which is kind of it's the first time I've actually seen it marketed to just the regular folk. So cool. All right, let's go ahead and move on to reviews.
Here are this week's reviews.
This week we have Blonde.
Miss Monroe, it's time.
You get your start?
Maybe.
What start?
In movies.
Quite continental. But diamonds are a girl's best friend.
I guess I was discovered. know you're supposed to get used to it.
And we all lose our jobs in the end.
But I just can't.
Square cut or pear shape. These
I've played Marilyn Monroe. Marilyn Monroe. Marilyn Monroe. Doing another scene with Marilyn Monroe.
So this is, I don't know if you'd call it a biopic. You're probably
it's based on a novel,
right?
On her life.
It's based on a fictionalized novel of Marilyn Monroe by an author, Joyce Carol Oates, from about 20 years ago. This is a, I guess you'd be forgiven if you were fooled into thinking this was supposed to be a legit biopic of Marilyn Monroe.
Yeah.
That's Ana de Armas playing Marilyn Monroe. This is premiering on Netflix this week. It's in theaters right now. Cody, tell us about Blonde and what you thought of it.
Yeah, so this is from director Andrew Dominik, who I don't know, were you a fan or have you even seen, I guess, The Assassination of Jesse James?
I never did. No, I know the movie. I never did see it.
Super great. Underrated and maybe at this point appropriately rated movie, because I think a lot of people latched onto it. Great Casey Affleck performance.
Mm-hmm.
But he did this movie a few years back, which is truly underrated, which is Killing Them Softly. A movie that got like a terrible cinema score, and also on Rotten Tomatoes was I mean, I think it bounced back a little bit on Rotten Tomatoes at like 75%, but like I don't know how well you remember that movie.
I never did see that one either. That's a Brad Pitt. It's Brad Pitt, right?
Yeah,
it is Brad Pitt.
And it has like a fucking outstanding James Gandolfini.
Oh fuck! Yeah. God damn it! That's like right when he died. Yeah.
And he's so good in it. And so I think Andrew Dominik's a super interesting filmmaker. And you know, there's been a lot being made of this movie and its sort of like development. I'm sorry, were you going to say something?
You froze for a second. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah. There's been a lot being made of the movie and its development. You know, from the casting of Ana de Armas as Marilyn Monroe. You know, a Cuban actress who doesn't super resemble her as she normally presents. And then, of course, the NC-17 rating, which Netflix is, you know, taking a risk on, and that kind of like kills its theatrical propositions, as if being a Netflix wasn't hard enough of a you know hurdle to clear to get into theaters, but nonetheless, you know, came out at Cannes or Venice, I can't remember, I think Venice actually, I don't know. It's difficult to know what to say here. I'll start with Ana de Armas, who I think does a fine job. I think that you know, you can hear it in the trailer, but it's, you know, she's really leaning into sort of like the breathy Marilyn Monroe voice.
Yeah, her accent slips in
a little
every
bit.
Now and then. Yeah,
for the most part, I was not bothered by it.
No, I'm not either.
I think that a lot of people might have thought they would be, and I'm here to say it's not bothersome.
There's plenty of other stuff to be worried.
Yeah. and I think, you know, she does, you know, she's asked to cry a lot and break down a lot and provide an emotionally raw performance. And I think she does a fine job. I think she's a good actress, and I don't think that the faults of this movie are on her shoulders. I think that the movie is just written in a way that, you know, it kind of treats Marilyn Monroe as obviously a tragic figure, but sort of like a constant victim of something.
Right.
Whether that's abuse, whether that's, you know, manipulation, whether that's, I think the thing about it is that the abuse is constant, and it's, and there's no really letting up, especially as you go through different relationships within her life and seeing that it's always there. She's always taken advantage of, or, you know, doing something that she doesn't want to do or something like that. It really leans heavily into, like, I will just say daddy issues, in that she calls basically every man in her life at some point daddy. It's not subtle at all. and I think the thing is that it doesn't really, you know how sometimes movies like this for people who have tragic endings are meant to sort of like, humanize them and to empathize with them, you know, sort of to a lesser extent, but sort of, I was thinking like the Sharon Tate Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, you know, designed to be like a redemption exploration of this, of her
and
as
I
a
mean,
person.
I was talking to my wife after we watched it last night, kind of reminded me a little bit of, and on a different level, like I, Tanya.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Where, you know, you have like, not, and I don't want this to sound the wrong way, but you put none of the flaws in the person's life on them. Mm-hmm. Like in that sort of redemption, like, cause I feel like I, Tanya, let Tanya Harding off the hook.
Right.
And I feel like, not that Marilyn Monroe needed to be let off the hook, but one of the problems with this film that I have is that there's absolutely nothing that is ascribed to her having any sort of like agency as a person. Like, well, everything is done to her. Everything about her life is done to her, according to this film.
Yeah, and I think too, and I was going, and my opinion is in a slightly different direction, which is that I don't think it does anything to create that arc of like recapturing her as a person or as an actress, mm-hmm. or as a cultural figure. It doesn't, you know, it doesn't really lean into the idea that she loved acting or that she was an artist or
that anything other than a fucking victim, anything other than just a terribly put upon victim.
Yeah, no, she's a doormat the whole time. And again, not that, you know, if this is accurate to the actual person, it's a very sad story. And I'm sure that it is. And I have no doubts about that. But I also think that, like, the movie feels punishing as a result, where this movie is near 3 hours long, and it's a constant barrage of, like, she's being physically abused, she's being emotionally abused, she's going through failed pregnancies, she's, you know, she's being manipulated, and, like, it's just, it's nonstop, and it doesn't, it like, and that kind of thing doesn't stop. And maybe that's the point. Like, maybe the point is to show her as a figure where she was constantly, you know, put in these types of position. But also, like, you know, there's opportunities here to explore the fame of Marilyn Monroe and what that did to her in her situations. And it just doesn't go there. Like, the abusers in her life get more character complexity than she does. And that doesn't feel fair either. You know, like, why is Arthur Miller a more interesting character than Marilyn Monroe in this movie? But it is. I think that Adrian Brody's character is more interesting in this. So, like, and then there's stuff like, you know, why is she in a thruple in the first part of this movie?
And that's one of the constructs of the novel. Like, there's, like, that's not something that happened.
Right.
Like, and it's, you know, with Charlie Chaplin Jr. and Edward G. Robinson Jr. are the characters. And I mean, I guess it's meant to kind of mirror the daddy issues that she has, but it makes...
If you're taking liberties with that kind of thing, then you can also take liberties to lighten the thing up too, you know? And so, again, it's just a punishing watch, and I don't think, again, it has this, like, exploration or redemption of Marilyn Monroe or Norma Jean as a person. I think instead it's just this constant barrage of, you know, ugliness that was... you know, part of her life, and done so in a way where, like, it just doesn't feel very human. Like, I think it's meant to elicit empathy, but really it's just like, she's not as well-rounded of a character, or written to be as well-rounded of a character to get that full effect.
Well, yeah, there's no humanity to her. Mm-hmm. Like, her, the way the movie has her living is, again, entirely as a victim. And that's the entirety of the movie is her being a victim. And I guess there's probably a point to this. There's probably a point that this is, you know, how she was chewed up and spit out by the world at large. And I think that's a fair point to make. But I think that it also doesn't do the character of Marilyn Monroe and by that extension the legacy of Marilyn Monroe any favors by portraying her as this just walked upon person with no sense of joy in her life, constantly reacting to everything, and constantly having everything done to her. Like, there's no explanation as to, and again, I'm not trying to victim blame or anything here, but I mean, what role did she have in her own goddamn life? You know, according to this movie, she had no agency in her life at all. And maybe, again, maybe that's supposed to be kind of the point, but
done so in a 3-hour punishing way.
Oh God. Feels like... And I mean, everything, I mean, I read a review of this earlier and I can't remember which critic it was, but it said it's like a series of her either going into a room where somebody's awful to her or already being in the room and somebody comes in and is awful to her. Like, it's just, it's just all it is. And for a movie that seems to be commenting on the fact that she was exploited sexually, it does a lot of sexual exploitation of its own for some reason. Like, Ana de Armas is nude a lot in this movie for not any real particular reason.
Right.
And then there's a scene that that probably earned it its NC-17 rating, that features Marilyn Monroe and JFK, that's grotesque in its, like, just, I don't know what you would call it, but like,
it adds nothing.
Right. And it, other than to be just more humiliation and more abuse piled upon this woman. Man, I don't get it. You know, it's, and I've seen a lot of people compare this to the Elvis movie. You know, the Elvis movie is a huge glossy thing. Like, it's not, it's, don't take it as accurate. It, you know, it hits high points and is glossy and sanitized, but it was captivating in a way that personally for me, that this thing is just revolting. Like, the Elvis was as captivating as this is revolting. Like, I was watching this, we got like 15 minutes into this, I think, and I was like, what the fuck is happening in this movie? Not to mention the, you know, in addition to the story thing, the kind of weirdness with the direction. There's a lot of changing aspect ratios.
Changing color to black and white.
Yeah. There's some really impressive reproductions in here. There's some stuff that's like jaw-droppingly good. Like, if you couldn't quite tell it was Ana de Armas, you'd swear they were showing like film footage from the original films that she was in. And then there's some stylistic touches that I think work, even though it kind of hammers it over your head, like the 7-year itch scene, the famous skirt blowing up, the movie portrays it as being watched by this just massive crowd of people, which I guess is a commentary on just the exploitative nature of the whole thing. But goddamn, could this movie let up a little fucking bit, and give us something to latch onto to be? Was her life tragic? I'm sure it was. Were there probably good moments? I would assume. I would hope. Does the movie have a bleakness? Like, I don't know. I think the movie just is trying to be as bleak as possible, and it doesn't.
Yeah.
It's not good for, it's not good because of it.
Yeah.
I don't know. But I did like Ana de Armas quite a bit. I feel like she threw the whole movie on her shoulders, and for better or worse.
Yeah. And again, to your point on some of that stuff, I just think that visually the movie looks gorgeous for the most part.
Yeah.
I don't necessarily agree with every single stylistic piece of it, but it looks beautiful. Like, it's just super well shot. It's really creatively shot at times. The black and white footage I think looks really great.
But what does it mean? What does it mean? Like, it doesn't have any significance. And there's times where the, like, most of it is 4x3, I think. And then it will expand to widescreen. And then, like, a couple times it shrinks to like almost vertical iPhone video.
Yeah. I mean, it just, what it feels like is it feels like a super expanded, like, character thesis art film kind of thing, where it's just like, Yeah, this is Marilyn Monroe doing all of these things, and but it doesn't mean a lot.
Yeah. Anyway, what is your grade for Blonde, Cody?
God, I'm gonna go with a C. I think that that accurately puts across how I felt about the movie, while also acknowledging the craft of it that I think is there. What be that Ana de Armas' performance, the you know, the cinematography, you know, there's elements of that that work, but I think that's about it. So I'll go with a C.
Yeah, I'm gonna go with a C minus. I just found it too punishing. I mean, and punishing for the character and punishing for the viewer.
Yeah.
Just to be like, there is some stuff that I think is nice, but man, it is a tough watch, and not in a like, oh man, I'm glad I got through that. It's like, man, this is not a fun time. But that is on Netflix starting this Friday, I believe. So if you want to catch it in theaters, you can. It's NC-17 if it's showing in a theater around you. But
check your local nudie theater.
Check your go buy it under the cover of night.
We apologize for being a day early and not able to cover the Munsters.
Well, we should do it this coming week, Cody, because we do have another movie coming out.
Yeah, I'm gonna be out of town, so.
Oh, damn it!
If we can push it to like, we should be having this off mic, but if we could push it to like Tuesday or Wednesday of next week and do a late week show.
Sure, because we are seeing Bros this week. A movie that I'm looking forward to.
I've heard good things. I'm actually not going to get to go to the screening, but after all,
man. Well, Cody.
But I do plan on seeing it because I'm really curious about it, and I've heard really good things. So
it's an Apatow movie, and I'm a big fan of Billy Eichner. I like Billy on the Street. I don't know if you ever watched Billy on the Street.
Yeah.
He's been doing little one-offs. He did one with Paul Rudd, and I think one with Jack Black came out today, which is fun to watch.
Yeah, and also too the I believe it's Nick Stoller who directed it too, who I think
yes
is
did
is
Forgetting Sarah Marshall, right? And
Forgetting Sarah Marshall. He also did Neighbors, Get Him to the Greek, 5-Year Engagement, which is probably the least good. Neighbors 2.
He was a co-writer for the Muppets.
That's right. Yeah.
Which, that movie, I loved that movie so much, and then they just squandered it.
I never saw Muppets Most Wanted.
It's not good. It's like, Muppets Most Wanted, I mean, it's fine. But it's like, it's starring everybody's second choice. Because Jason Segel did, and Amy Adams weren't back. So, like, it stars, it's like Ricky Gervais, Tina Fey, and Ty Burrell.
Oh.
So like, it's like fine people, fine cast, but like this doesn't seem like anybody's first choice. Anyway, if you want to reach us, you can email us at podcast@cinesnob.net. You can find us on Twitter @CineSnob, Facebook CineSnob Critic, CineSnob.net. What?
The Munsters is an hour and 50 minutes long.
Jesus. I saw that.
You want to double down on that?
We have to talk about it because that trailer was met with instant derision.
Yeah.
Like that's one of the worst trailers I've seen. And I saw the Confess Fletch trailer. I'm very curious about the Munsters. Did you ever watch it as a kid?
Mm-mm.
I don't know if it was kicking around because we watched it as kids in my house. I know the Addams Family was like a contemporary and that became more popular because of the movies, but.
Yeah,
this Munsters, it's on Netflix, so why the fuck not? If I don't gotta pay to see it,
that's true.
It is coming out on DVD and Blu-ray the same day too. I saw somebody posted on one of the Facebook groups I'm in that they actually snagged it at Walmart tonight. So if you're itching to see the Munsters, check your local Walmart. They may have broken street date.
Well, there's only 3 reviews on Rotten Tomatoes right now, and. Not great.
Is it at 0 or is it not?
There's not enough, but there's 2 reviews that are 1 out of 5 stars and then 1 D+. So.
Oh, well. Promising.
Yeah.
All right. Anything else before we go, Cody?
No, we'll have something coming up, and then I'll probably have a written review or two of a Fantastic Fest film on CineSnob.net. And so, yeah, if you want to follow along, go there.
All right. On that note, I'm Jerrod Kingery.
I'm Cody Viavagno.
Thank you for listening to the CineSnob podcast. To read reviews, interviews, and more, visit CineSnob.net. See you next week.